Hi, topic today, I titled it Lady Sings the Blues. I'm Lila White from Singapore. I created this platform so people like you and me can connect and share experiences, similar experiences sometimes. I have the wonderful Melissa here. She's going to share the topic about postnatal blues, and I'm trying to ward off mosquitoes at the same time. Melissa, why don't you introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about your background.
Hi, so I'm Melissa Demasiers. I've been in Singapore for about 11 years now. I came originally, I moved here from Paris after studying to work with an auction house here, Sotheby's. So I'm more of an art specialist. And I met my husband here, and we had a beautiful little baby boy about 3.5 years ago. Yeah, so.
That's so cute. I'm going to kidnap him when I leave. So Melissa, we are, the topic that we talk about is postnatal blues,
yes.
Right? So I'm so happy that you are willing to share this with us, because I know there's a lot of us that goes through and don't want to talk about it because it's a taboo subject. So can you please tell us the question I want to ask you is, what is postnatal blues?
Well, postpartum depression or postnatal depression, it's quite a, how do you say, broad topic. I mean, there's a lot of broad spectrum, so basically it can go from anything like a baby blues that you have, you know, most women experience maybe, you know, a week or up to 2 weeks after they have a baby, which is quite normal. It's you know, feelings of, you know, maybe not being able to cope with your baby, fears that come with being a new parent, and all that is quite common. Just postpartum depression is when sort of lingers on much longer and gets sort of, you know, the fog sort of gets thicker and thicker, and you realize that you really have trouble bonding with your baby, and also you're not your normal self, basically. So it's a clinical issue, and you know, I think it's wasn't really talked about, you know, in the past, you know, during our grandmother's generation and all that. I think it's always been there. It's just now we doctors have sort of, you know, been able to come out and analyze it a lot more and recognize it as a real problem that women go through, and sometimes men too, you know,
yeah,
like dealing with a newborn baby.
Because
how that affects family and the changes.
Because
yeah.
I read that 15% of women go through it, but 1 to 3%, if I'm not mistaken, 1 to 16% new fathers go through it.
Absolutely, because I think just anyway, having a baby for the first time, it's a complete, you know, new dynamic for the couple, for the family structure. It's extremely difficult to find your bearings again, I think,
mm-hmm.
especially maybe also if you're both working parents, trying to juggle career as well as, you know, being parents. It's overwhelming, you know, and it's I think it's human nature to get overwhelmed, but sometimes it just gets to the point where it's just too hard to cope, and that's when you need to ask for help, basically.
Right.
Yeah.
So may I ask, whether did you go through it yourself?
I did very much, and it was interesting because, like most people, I think that suffer or go through postpartum depression or anxiety disorder, which I'll explain later, which is a bit more what I had.
Okay.
It's very hard to recognize at first, you know, because, okay, here you are with a baby, you know, it's all a little bit new, sleepless nights, you're overtired. For me, breastfeeding was also a huge challenge, which I think probably aggravated my situation, you know. And basically, I recognized it because I just had trouble bonding with my baby. I think that was the worst part of it. I mean, there was this little child, something deep down inside, I knew I loved him,
yeah.
But I didn't quite know if this was enough love. It was like I felt guilty, I felt I was an inadequate mother, I felt I had, you know, shortcomings, and I felt that I was not, how do you say, fully in control of the situation. And I thought somehow I had thought motherhood was going to be this magical experience, you know, everyone sort of, it's very much marketed as this wonderful, blissful thing, and actually it can be a complete nightmare when it happens.
Yeah.
And so I didn't recognize that. I just thought, okay, maybe it's just really tough and this is what I'm supposed to experience. But at the same time, I knew deep down there was something that was wrong, because I felt like my soul had kind of departed. I don't know how to describe it better, but it's sort of I felt also this oversense, this feeling of doom and gloom that I couldn't shake off. And that fog kind of got darker and darker as the months went by. Things didn't get easier, they just got harder and harder for me, you know? So that's when I recognized that I needed perhaps help, you know? I think it was about 6 months in that I would, I remember sitting, you know, at home one night, the baby had gone to sleep, and I was with my husband, and I said, you know, I think I need help. I think this is not normal that I'm going, you know, 6 months into this new parenthood, and I just can't cope. You know, I have no joy in any of this. I don't feel like I love and cherish myself. I have difficulty bonding with the baby. I also don't know how I feel towards you, you know? I mean, it was quite sad for my husband too, because it's very difficult to say things like that, but I had to explain it so that I could get help too, right? So, and he said, yeah, you probably should, because he didn't know also how to lend a hand. He tried his best, but he said maybe you need outside help, you know, medical help or, you know, health professionals.
Yeah. That's so wonderful that you even have that support system from your husband, right?
Yeah.
Because I didn't have postpartum depression or postpartum abuse. I remember that, I remember when I gave birth to Zaviera, that there was, you know, I couldn't say I love her. Like most women, like, oh, you know, it's a natural
thing,
right?
It's
the pressure of society that's putting on you.
Yeah.
Through discovery of taking care of her as she grows older, I mean, as day by day, I could bond with her, and that's where love comes in.
Absolutely.
You know, for me, it was personally taking care of somebody and loving and finding love, and through taking care of them, that's how I show love and that's how I receive love.
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely.
But I think you're absolutely right, the pressure of women saying that, oh, the minute the baby is out,
it's there,
you know,
it's going to be this blissful thing. And I think it's very misconstrued. I think it's also, and people, you know, motherhood, because it's associated with all positive things generally, like love, like well-being, and, you know, caring for another human being, it's almost like you can never say that there's anything bad about it. And I think that's what makes it extremely taboo also to a lot of women to want to talk about it, because it's like, well, if I admit that I'm not, you know, feeling what I'm supposed to feel, what society says I'm supposed to feel, then I'm a bad mother, or I'm a bad human being, I'm inadequate, I'm ungrateful, which is, you know, I had even friends tell me that you're, Melissa, you're ungrateful, you know, like, especially friends who had trouble conceiving or who were going through many rounds of IVF, you know, they just couldn't understand how I had this beautiful, healthy baby and I just couldn't get on with it. You know, I just couldn't love him. I just didn't really want to hold him that much. Like I said, breastfeeding was a nightmare. I felt it was completely, you know, taking away, you know, parts of me, you know, and I became very resentful to all of that. But it's just, it is societal pressure for sure, you know, part of it, you know. And then there's also, I mean, I talked to one of my cousins in France who's a clinical psychologist, and she did explain that there are, how do you say, you do have sort of predispositions in certain families for depression, for anxiety, you know. So there is, you know, part of it is also genetically linked. I'm not saying all of it, of course, but there is sort of predisposition in certain families. And you know, I remember as a child, I was also quite melancholic about certain things. I was more reserved, quiet. And I think sort of, you know, my mom always said that, oh, you're so, you know, you're such an easy child. Everything just goes along well. And she's like, but I'm just worried that one day you might have a breakdown for something, you know. And it's interesting because I think when I had this baby, that's when I had my breakdown. For women, it's menopause. Or for women, it's some other people, it's losing a dear one, you know, dealing with death. I mean, there's so many things, work. And for me, it was that trigger point. I think having a child just completely 360 changed my life, you know, my outlook.
But I think it should, because most people don't see it as, this is another human being that you don't know. You just care, you just get to know that person. So that I read somewhere, I saw a documentary, I can't remember the title of it, but I also don't remember which culture, that they don't shove the baby to the mother as soon as the baby's given birth.
Okay.
So they let the mother, you know, get herself together, and when the mother asks, then the baby is born. So this, you know, this immediate, instant connection that's been forced, you know, you have like, you know, what do you call it, have many hours of giving birth, and then childbirth labor, and then the baby's shoved into your face, and you're supposed to born and feel happy. I'm in pain.
Absolutely. I mean, I felt like that even in the hospital. I remember, you know, the nurses coming in, wheeling him in, you know, okay, you have to breastfeed now, come on, breastfeed. And it was like, you had all these cheerleaders around you, and inside you just felt like you wanted to die. And it's horrible because it's sort of, you know, you feel extremely, extremely alone. I think I tell a lot of my friends too, who I share this with now, for me, motherhood, the beginning of motherhood, let's say, or the year I went through my postpartum, it was an extremely isolating experience. I think that's one of the key things. And parenthood in general can be an extremely isolating experience. I think raising kids, it doesn't come with a manual. You know how you're supposed to feel. And like I said, the dynamics change everything. You know, I still felt like I needed my mother, but I was becoming a mother, you know. So I was like, how does that work? You know, where is my place? And what happens to my work, my career? And, you know, so all these questions come up. It just becomes this ball, and then you just sort of explode.
It's a big deal. I think pregnancy is a big deal.
It is.
I think giving birth is a big deal. Raising a child is a big deal. But people don't want to talk about it because they think that it's a natural thing and we are supposed to live through it. And I think the more we talk about it, somebody out there will know that this is natural.
Yeah.
And it's a good way to find help also.
Absolutely.
On that note also, at the end of this show, I will be putting up some links and support group that you can go to.
Yeah.
I think you're very blessed with Michael, who is the biggest support group.
Absolutely. Right? Yeah, I had a wonderful husband who actually was the one who encouraged me to really, also seek medical help, professional help, because for example, for my parents, who I had a very, very close relationship to, I mean, we have an amazing relationship, for them, they just couldn't understand. It was like I was being overly dramatic, or I wouldn't say even lazy about it, but they just couldn't get the idea that their daughter, who had been, you know, perfect student, I had a good, you know, start to life, everything was going well, I had a wonderful husband, everything. This was a challenge, you see, they just couldn't get their heads around it. And I think it's only, you know, it's Max, my son is 3 years old now. I think it's honestly, and I hate to admit it, it's only now that they're really understanding or admitting themselves that I had an issue. And I think a big part of it for me was also to get them to accept, recognize and understand that yes, I had an issue. I had a problem, a psychological mental issue. And that doesn't make me a weaker or bad person. It's just something I had to go through. But I think that's very key, like what you said, for people to recognize it and accept it and not make it such a taboo issue, because that's the worst. Because then you're isolating people, and you know, it's so hard naturally to ask for help. So
where did you get help from?
So for me, it was interesting because I was quite lucky in the sense. I mean, like I said, it was part of depression or anxiety disorder, the spectrum is so broad. So you have extremely severe cases where, I mean, you know, women have suicidal thoughts, they want to harm themselves or cause harm to their baby. And, you know, you have many, many cases, you know, all over the world, in Europe, I mean, even in Asia, but especially in the States too, you know, about women committing suicide or harming their baby, and because they just can't cope, you know, and it can be 3 years in, 4 years in, and someday, you know, the switch just blows up and something dramatic happens, or it can be, you know, 2 months in. So from that requires, and I really, this is really not a disclaimer, but I want to say, I mean, if you do have severe case of postpartum, you do need, you know, probably medical, like proper medical and psychological care, which is, you know, not what I had. I went a more holistic route,
right?
So I was always a bit skeptical of holistic medicine, you know, about homeopathy and naturopathy. And my husband, he's German, and you know, in Germany they're very, very, very they believe a lot in natural healing, like the Swiss, you know, and even in India, they have this kind of culture of natural healing and natural doctors. doctors and all that. He said, look, why don't you just try that out first before starting to take the medication that is often given to women to treat depression, like Zoloft or Prozac or other sort of, you know, pretty strong medicines. So I said, okay, I'll give it a try. I mean, I was very skeptical. And I went to see, at first I went to see my chiropractor because I just had a lot of body pain too. And, you know, I was a mess when I went to see him. I was crying. I just couldn't get myself together. I had this overwhelming feeling of sadness and doom, you know, and I couldn't shake it off. And I told him, please, you need to help me, you know. And he's like, you know, Melissa, I can only treat you physically for whatever pain you're manifesting now. But I think, you know, the human is made of chemical, emotional, and physical. And when all of that is out of whack and it's not, you know, centered, then you need to address the issues one by one. So he's like, what sounds to me like you need emotional help, but you also need maybe some chemical help, because, you know, there's also the chemical imbalance that comes with hormone fluctuations after giving birth, with your endorphins not being, you know, on the go again and all that. So there's definitely that. So he's like, look, you should go see perhaps a homeopath and maybe do some hypnotherapy. Sounds all a little bit, you know, light for what I have. You guys don't realize how much I'm suffering. Is this really gonna help, you know? And but I did go. I actually had read, you know, on the internet that when you have, how do you say, depression or anxiety, it's good to also pick up an activity that sort of centers you, you know, just sort of calms you down a little bit, whether it's knitting, it can be painting, pottery, whatever. And I always loved to paint, so I had started a painting class. And there, this teacher of ours could see that I was there for a reason, that I was, you know, trying to deal with some issues. And she suggested to me to go see a wonderful homeopath, Dr. Priya, who's actually in Singapore. And she said, you know, she's quite in tune with women's issues and she may be able to help, and it's good to have someone to talk to that is not your immediate family. I think that's also quite key, to have someone who's not your husband, not your friends, not your family, because everyone will judge.
Yeah,
that's
true.
The thing. It's just part of it, part and parcel. You know, people will judge. Even your husband will judge you, you know, even though he doesn't need to. And she's like, get someone who is completely neutral to your experience. And so I went to see this homeopath. And she was amazing for me because she really broke it down. She sort of, because it was this huge fog, and she said, no, it's okay, you have, you know, classic case of postpartum anxiety, because I was having a lot of panic attacks too. And she's like, you're just going to have to take baby steps. And she said, it's going to take a long time. And I think that's what probably most people who are sick anyways don't want to hear. It's going to take a long time, because you're like, just get me out of this already, you know? And she said, no, you're going to do baby steps and it's going to take you at least a year, year and a half. So for me, you know, when you're in this tunnel and someone tells you that, you're like, I'm not going to make a year and a half, you know, with living like this, with constant panic attacks, the not being able to travel, no joy in anything I do. I couldn't even read a book, you know, because I just had no interest in anything. So she made me keep a diary. She made me write down every single day how I felt. She had a special scale of how often I cried, how deep was my doom level, my feelings of, you know, feeling trapped and, you know, all that. So very, very specific diary every single day. And with that, she gave me homeopathic medicine to treat my moods, basically. And they were very, very specific doses linked very much of what I was writing in my diary. You know, it was very much, it wasn't like she prescribed me just one medicine, said just pop that whenever you feel bad. Because that's also not the solution. She said that's like putting a band-aid on your wound and it's just going to be ripped out again. She's like, we have to treat the root cause, and that's what homeopathy does. Treat the root cause of what it is that's creating this anxiety. Because of course it is linked to the birth of your child, but maybe this backlog from before too, you know, like stresses you had from childhood or, you know, when you grew up and all that. She's like, we need to clear all that so you can recenter yourself.
It makes so sense. It makes a lot of sense. I think that talking to you, and I've known you for some time, you're the bubbly person. I can't imagine, you know, but also also, I want to touch back on this suicide, the amount of women that have committed suicide.
Yeah.
And I heard stories of, you know, friends seeing their friend all bubbly and funny with the friends, but then you just, something happens, they just jump.
They jump, yeah, exactly. And you have no idea. It's like, I was reading also about, you know, people seeing photos of themselves when they are in a depressive state, maybe a year back or whatever, and they're like, and they can look completely happy, you know, in the photo, they're hugging their child or whatever, but inside they're dying, you know. So that's why, I mean, depression is so hard to recognize, and it's got so many different levels and shades of it that you just never know, which is why you just need to constantly, you know, keep an open mind about it, you know, ask for help when you're not feeling right. It's okay, and you don't need to feel ashamed. Yeah, but suicide is a huge thing amongst postpartum. Yeah, I had a friend actually who I talked to about, and I didn't know she had postpartum. It's only when she visited me recently, because she moved back to Europe, and she said, you know, I know exactly how you feel. It's just I had it a lot worse because I felt like I wanted to put my baby in the oven. I wanted to leave. She's like, I'd be driving down in Paris, and you know, they have those huge dumpsters, you know, on the side of the road. And she's like, I thought maybe if I just leave my baby there, you know, and it'll work out, you know, and then I could just move on. I mean, she had really, really dark, dark thoughts, and she's like, you know, now she has two beautiful kids, and she's like, do not imagine these thoughts I had to live with, and they just come like that, you know. She's like, how can I get to that? She's like, I'm not crazy, but you know, yet at the same time, you feel like you are crazy because these thoughts just come, you know. And I never was to the point, I'd say, of suicide, but I definitely had dark thoughts that would come at night. I would think, should I actually be here? Is it really necessary for me to be here? Like, I think Michael can cope, you know, he's the main breadwinner. My parents really take good care. We have a wonderful nanny. So maybe I can just go. Well, go mend, it can be just disappear or just run off or whatever, but I just didn't feel I was needed in this experience, you know. And that was my dark thought. Was sometimes I had so much anxiety and pain, like the panic attacks were so strong. I sometimes thought, well, how about if I just jump from the window just to knock my head a little bit so then it'll shake me up, you know. So it's sort of that creeps in when you say it's suicide, but it's those thoughts do creep up, you know. And it was horrible because when I look back on it now, I just think, you know, it must have been really bad for me to have thought that,
right,
you know?
But for you to even think it, it's, I mean, for somebody that doesn't go through it, you go like, whoa, you know, that's,
yeah.
But for you,
it's
to
extreme.
Do that,
yeah.
But for you to do that in my when I'm listening to it, it's like, wow, I just want to get well because I don't even want to be this way.
That's
because
right.
This is not the feeling that I
that's
want.
Right. You just want to get well, and that's the thing. It's this tunnel, and you just can't see the light. So even my husband took me, for example, he thought it would help. He took me to my favorite, you know, hotel. We went for a getaway, you know, in Thailand. Everything was amazing. And I just had panic attack after panic attack. I was miserable. I just was, you know, telling him, please help me, please help me. And he was just like, darling, I don't know what to do. You're here. It's fine. Nothing's moving. And I was suffering so much inside, and nothing could get rid of it. You know, you almost don't even see your husband. You're just kind of like, you're so trapped in your pain and suffering that, it's completely isolating.
Let's talk about this panic attack.
Yes.
How does that feel?
So panic attack, maybe can be different for you know, people, but classic symptoms is very much, you know, shortness of breath. That just comes on like that. So nothing really triggered it. I could be in the middle of Orchard Road, and I was at my first big panic attack. I was banking, and suddenly I just couldn't move. I was in the middle of Orchard Road. I had extreme shortness of breath, dizziness. I felt like the ground was going to open up. I was going to die, basically, that some sort of apocalypse was going to happen. And a very good description is, like, I felt like I had cling wrap being wrapped around me, and I couldn't breathe. I was grasping for air, and you just feel extremely weak and extremely scared. There's a huge fear that comes with it. And one of the interesting symptoms too with a panic attack is you can also feel like you need to pass motion, like, you know, because you are not in control of your bowel system anymore. So you feel like you need to defecate, you know, you need to go to the toilet immediately, or you know, you just have no control, so it just comes like that and sinks down to this tummy area, and you just feel like you're losing absolute control of your body. And then it's like a wave, so it's like a really big wave that comes, and then slowly it recedes again, you know. So panic attacks don't last for hours, but you know, they reach a peak and then they sort of come back, and you just never know when they come. I had them in, you know, when we were driving on the highway, I had to tell my husband, can you stop now? I think I'm gonna die, you know, like I couldn't breathe. So he was in the middle of the highway and he'd have to stop the car and be like, okay, help me breathe, and you know. So that's a classic panic attack, yeah.
So do you think that you get a lot of support system after, like for example, you went to the
homeopath.
Do you somehow during time get a grasp of what it is? Right? Because not knowing what it is the scariest thing, because you're feeling all this emotion. So finally a glimpse of, you know, like, okay, I understand what it
hope.
Is.
Yeah,
hope.
Yeah.
So when you start talking to people, like friends or whatever, who understand, you feel a bit relieved.
You mean now or when I was going
when,
through
when
it?
You were going through it.
Yeah, I think what was interesting also is a lot of the few people that I tried to talk to about it, I mean, I have to say 60% of my friends didn't understand. Like you said, they're like, oh, you're extremely bubbly, you know, always very sociable, and just lots of, you know, go out and parties and all that. And she's like, you must just be going through a phase, you know? So it was hard to talk about it, but I had a few people who did say, okay, it's good what you're doing. Yeah, I don't know. It's I had some people also tell me, oh, I just you know, people who had just had kids, they were like, yeah, I kind of get what you mean about feeling down, but I just don't have the time, you know. And I was like, what do you mean you don't have the time? You think I have all the time in the world and I want to feel like this? I'm sorry, but I don't. And you know, that's where you realize, God, there's a huge disconnect with people understanding this and treating it as a real medical issue, a psychological issue. And some people just say, oh, it's just a phase, we'll get through it. You know, I have friends say, oh, just take Prozac, you'll be fine tomorrow, you know, or take an antihistamine and then it'll calm down your panic attacks.
But that doesn't get rid of the real problem.
The real problem, you know, yeah.
But I think that we as human beings lack sympathy and time for people. You know, the real problem, I think, like I have friends that goes through it, and from having one child, they have another child, and then that's the guilt, you know, how do I feel with the next one? And there's a lot of guilt. I'm like, listen, you know, it's a natural emotion.
Yeah.
So as long as we learn that these emotions, whatever we have, are natural emotions, and how do we deal with it? That's a different story.
Yeah.
But guilt for women is the biggest thing.
It's a huge thing. Guilt coupled with fear, but yeah, I think guilt is huge, like you say. And I think we are very much groomed, especially my generation now. We are very much expected to have an amazing career, be an amazing mother, preferably have many kids if you can, if you're healthy, you know, and be this amazing wife and run marathons and climb Kilimanjaro, whatever, you know, just do so much. And sometimes you're like, well, can I really have it all? And I'm sure some women can, and some women, they just need, you know, a little less, you know, they can't do it all at the same time. And it's okay. That's what I want people to leave this with, is it's okay. You can only, you do the best you can at the end of the day. You do the best you can for your child, you do the best you can for yourself. And it's very, very, very important that you're happy, because then you can translate that happiness to anyone else, not your husband, not your child, you know. So you need to feel how you feel, deal with whatever you're dealing with, and it's okay if it takes time. You know, it's not immediate to become a parent, like you said. You know, my doctor told me, you know, you learn to become a parent, you learn to become a mother. It takes years, and you know, even many years in, you don't have it all figured out. I mean, I don't know how you feel with, like, your daughter.
Same,
it's also,
same.
Right? It's just every day is a learning experience.
I'm still trying to figure it out, trust me.
Yeah.
Every single day.
Yeah.
But what do you think needs to change?
I think just more dialogue. People just being the empathy, also, like you said, for people. I think just keeping the channels really open, speaking about it, which is also why I was very happy when Lila, you know, invited me to do this, because I know people don't talk about it. You know, it's taboo. Mental illness is taboo, but it's also, you know, the illness of the 20th and 21st century, you know? My husband thinks most people are depressed, you know? they just don't admit it. It's like almost a natural state of being, but we just kind of, you know, cope and we just move on and we try our best, and for some it works out and for some it doesn't, you know? So, you know, you can have also depression. A lot of men go through depression when they hit 40, right? To reevaluate their lives and, am I doing the right thing? This and that. So I mean, it happens to the very best of us, and it's okay. You know, don't feel ashamed. Ask for help. Whatever works for you, whether it can be as simple as meditation, yoga, taking up physical activity, to seeing maybe more naturopath, homeopath, or if you have, you know, you need severe help, you know, talking to the right psychologist, psychiatrist, taking the right medication. I mean, we're very fortunate that a lot of that is available to us now. Back in my grandmother's time, it wasn't. You know, you just had your six boys and you just dealt with it, and the best you could do is maybe go to what they call in Europe like a cure, you know, like a spa retreat, you know, like go take baths, you know, in the thermal baths, you know, and relax a bit, take a bit of sun, and then go back home. But, you know, probably a lot of these women were, you know, had much deeper rooted issues, and they didn't have the medication that was accessible, or all that was known at the time was maybe things like electroshock therapy, which was still used, you know, to treat, to trigger, you know, women and people dealing with mental illness, you know, because that, they thought that was the way to go about it, right? So we've come a long way, but I still think there's a lot to do, and I think just raising awareness is the key. At the end of the day, the more you talk about it, the more people will be familiar with it, you know. And it's okay. It doesn't make you a bad person. It doesn't make you weak, you know. And you just have to love yourself, you know. I think it's a little bit cliche, but it's absolutely key in being happy and being balanced, right? Too.
At the end of the day, none of us wants to feel weird and low.
No.
We want to know that there are other people that are facing the same problems or same similar situation.
Absolutely.
That you can connect and find help. At the end of the day, everybody wants to be happy.
Yeah.
You know, that's the goal, right?
Yeah, and of course, parenthood and having a child is a blessing, and it's a beautiful experience too. You know, I think when I got out of my fog, like I call it, about a year and a half in, and now I look back on it and it's all like a bad dream that I can't quite place anymore. It's almost like, it's not that it never happened. I know that it happened, but it's just, it's drifting away now like a cloud, you know? And it's like, do I fear that it will come back if I have my second child? Of course, I think there's 20%, if I'm honest, still holds me a little bit, and I am in fear of having my second child because I'm scared of it coming back. At the same time, I tell myself that you've been through it, so you know what to look out for.
Exactly.
You know, you have the tools now to cope with it if it happens again. If a panic attack comes, you know what to do. You know that you need to breathe. You know that it's a wave, that it will pass. You know who to talk to. And that's just what I'm working with, you know, now, you know, because, and it's normal to fear things. You know, it's okay. Fear is a natural, you know, response to a lot of things, you know, but you can't let it go. And I think for the longest time I also thought, you know, God, my baby's going to resent me later for being not so mentally present with him the first year, you know, and he doesn't. You know, I clearly see that. He's three, he's happy, he's thriving, we have such a loving relationship, and it's like, you know, kids are resilient too, you know, and they have natural empathy, you know, for adults, you know, that maybe we as adults have sort of, you know, barricaded ourselves from because you just want to be so perfect all the time. And it's just, you know,
I mean, they go through the same phases of phases also, in the sense that I've always told my kids this, that no matter how great, there's no such thing as a perfect parent or a great parent. Okay? No, I've seen parents that are like over indulging with their kids. At one stage, they're going to hate you. They say, I hate you. And then there are parents that go like, no, you can't do this. This is our rules. I hate you.
I hate you.
So they go through that phase.
Totally.
You know?
And you can never, it's never black and white, right? There's always gray areas. And it's part of the learning process. And I think, you know, it's it's part also of the beauty of parenthood, you know, these challenges that makes you look at yourself and make you be your better self so that they can be, you know, the best, you know, human beings you want them to be. And even from this experience, you know, when I talk about it now with my husband, I said, I think the key that things that I want to instill in my boy or my future children is to have empathy, like you said, to have compassion, because everyone is going through some sort of battle that you know nothing about. You know, it's that great saying, everyone is fighting something, some battle that you know nothing about. So be kind, you know, it just takes, you know, someone just listen to you or lend a helping hand. And you ask for help, you know, just be, I need help. It's okay to say, I need help. You know, I'm not feeling happy. I have difficulty bonding with my child. It's okay, you know. It's we're lucky that we can talk about it now, you know. Probably in the 50s we couldn't as much. You know,
yeah.
So.
But you'd be surprised that many women that until today don't talk about it. Because it's such a failure.
It's such a failure. It's seen as a weakness.
Yeah.
It's like counterintuitive to what a mother is supposed to be. Nurturing, caring, loving, happy, you know? So when you have that, when you have postpartum linked issues, it's kind of the opposite of what you think you're supposed to be feeling. So of course it's extremely terrifying and you feel horrible. You feel absolutely horrible and guilty.
Yeah.
Yeah, guilt just sort of eats at you, you know?
I think women, especially. If you have nothing nice to say, don't say it.
Don't say it.
Yeah. You know, just say, hey, listen, you know, I'm so sorry. I can't connect with this problem. Maybe you should talk to somebody else.
Exactly.
You know?
Yeah.
But you cannot impose your views, which you don't understand, on the person that's going through.
Yeah.
I think it's really unfair.
And I think also for the person who is suffering or going through postpartum, it's you also have to understand that it's very hard for the other party to not understand what you're going through. It was hard for my husband to understand. My parents, my brothers also didn't quite understand. I think it's still a little bit vague to them, probably what I went through. But it's not easy for people to understand. So it's okay, you know. Don't resent them for it,
right.
You know, because I think in the first 6 months I resented my husband for not going through the pain I was going. I'm like, how come you get to be happy and I don't with this child? You know, how come you'd maybe deserve it? So it's okay. You have to also, it's hard when you're in that state, but you also have to be patient and kind towards the people who are trying to help you maybe, but just don't know how to go about it, you know. So
I think the tips that you gave were very, very crucial. Like take up something that grounds you.
Grounding,
yeah. So you did painting.
I did painting, I took up a little bit of yoga, which I had never done. My doctor also told me basic things, you know. Reconnect with nature, you know, ground yourself. It sounds very cheesy and very cliche, but it's so true. Walk on the grass barefoot, touch trees, breathe, you know. And I'm lucky to be living in quite a green area, so she's like, you know, just even if it's talking to your plants, you know, walking in the rain, whatever, just reconnect with something that is not of your immediate world, you know, something that's a little bit bigger than you. You know, some people it's meditation. I was raised Buddhist and that helped me too. I mean, I don't want to, you know, spirituality and religion is very personal, but I think the spiritual component also did help me in the sense that chanting, you know, reciting mantras with even the help of my mother, that also helps. It's a form of meditation too, of just centering yourself, you know. And you always talk, now you talk a lot about chakras, you know, and how important they are to be reconnected and balanced. And my doctor, who is Indian, Dr. Priya, she said, you know, it's like when you have this baby and all the hormonal changes and this and that, your chemical changes, all your chakras sort of burst open and it was like a floodgate, you know, like, so you just need to recenter and rebalance yourself. And for me, painting was my meditative experience and helped me to center. For some people, it can be as easy as, you know, embroidery, pottery, it can be, you know, I don't know, anything. Just walking around the block sometimes helps, you know. But a small activity like that, that doesn't require, how do you say, future planning or something too complicated. Just a day-to-day small activity helps, I think. Doesn't cure it. It helps definitely a little bit.
But do you also think that it's reconnecting to yourself, with yourself, alone, by yourself, right?
Yeah, very
because
much.
When you give birth, there's another individual that you don't know,
yeah.
So it's been thrown at you.
Yeah.
And let's talk about in the olden days where you mentioned that they go to the spa.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah,
and
thermal baths.
Yeah, thermal
and, yeah.
baths. That's actually getting away from all the chaos
yeah.
and
yeah.
just being by
And
yourself.
Then when you come back, your problems are still there at home,
right.
you know,
right.
because you're not treating that much that core internal issue, you know, so... that's why some, you know, psychotherapy or psychoanalysis or, you know, talking to someone is also extremely helpful because, you know, we tend to keep things and keep things pent up and, you know, keep the sort of, you know, barricade us, protect ourselves from everything that we're going through every day. And I think talking is such a crucial part of helping yourself, like you say, dealing, being happy with yourself. Friend, or it can be someone who's completely outside to your experience.
Yeah.
Probably better actually, because then
it's
you won't feel judgment.
Yeah.
The judgment, you know. So yeah.
But I think also we are becoming a society of not making time for anybody. So you know, people don't actually sit down and say, "Hey, so how are you? How are you?"
Yeah.
But
fine, and then I go. You know, and it's
right.
kind of you know, yeah. You just to sit down, have a real conversation, or sometimes just sit down with someone and. Not talk, but just enjoy that silence and just to know that someone is there for you. That means the world, you know, sometimes. But we never stop. We're a completely excessive society, you know, if you think about it. With phones, with, you know, iPads and conference calls and, you know, this and that and rushing from one place. We're a completely excessive society, you know, and I think you need to learn to slow down. And I think sports is extremely good for that, you know. You know, just taking the time to the essentials, you know. I mean, I'm sure you see it in your line of work.
Yeah.
That, I mean, sport and just physical activity is crucial in well balance. I mean, it's just crucial, you know.
So if somebody, now that you know all the symptoms and all the stuff that you went through, so if somebody comes up to you, do you think that you are able to detect it or?
Mean in someone else?
In someone
or?
Else.
Tricky. I think it's hard, I wouldn't say, because like I said, it's so personal and varied case to case.
Yeah.
Certain people, I can sort of get a vague feeling when they talk about certain things or experiences that they might be struggling with something. So you kind of get a feeling, but you know, you also have to be very diplomatic and tread on, you know, be careful not to vex them too, because it's also their personal space and you don't want to jump at them. And if they're not ready, they might, you know, back off and be resentful, be like, why are you, you know, interfering with my life, you know? So you just, I definitely have more of a radar for it, if that's what you mean, you know? I definitely have a sensitivity to it. I can sort of feel it, and whether it's in men or women, you know, I have a very dear older male friends who I know are going through some stuff, you know, and they just don't want to talk about it. But it's just, you know, you're there. So that's why I say the more I talk about it, I'm open about it, maybe that will give someone the confidence to be like, okay, I can talk about it too, you know. And not just women, anyone, you know, a teenager all the way to, you know, a 60-year-old businessman, you know, it's depression, like so many other things, doesn't discriminate. It doesn't discriminate with gender, with social class, with, you know, any of that. It just can happen to anyone, you know.
But do you think that there's a fine line between depression, like the symptoms that you say, or all depression symptoms?
Yeah, exactly.
But somebody that is just a downer, like everything is weird, everything.
Yeah, someone who's pessimistic and
yeah.
negative.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's a bit hard for me to say. I mean, it's a fine line, right? I mean, you have people who are naturally neurotic and pessimistic and all that. Does that mean they're depressed? Not necessarily, you know. And then you have people who are extremely upbeat, happy, and go all the time who are actually depressed. So it's very hard to say. I couldn't say personally because it's a bit of a fine line, but one does not exclude the other, you know. What you think may be a very happy person can be completely down in the dumps when they go home. Have feelings of self-hate and self-torture and inadequacy, and the person who's just like a bit of a Woody Allen type, who's neurotic and, you know, this and that, can be actually fine. You know, it's just their way of being or their way of coping with life, you know, or situations.
Yeah, because I was shocked, like a couple of stories that I've heard of people that extremely just kill themselves, and nobody know and can tell.
Look at you know one of Robin Williams, right? One of the most amazing comedians, actors, I mean, extremely intelligent human being, who would have known, yeah, right? I mean, and you know, and you read a lot of these comedians also had depressive issues. You know, Charlie Chaplin, I think Jim Carrey had issues. You know, I think Owen Wilson had a bout of you know, near to suicide. So I mean, you know, it's all sometimes a facade, but also comedians, maybe it's a way for them to just deal with the day-to-day angst and trouble and anxiety and pain. Because depression is painful, you know, and it manifests physically too. You can't get out of bed, you cry, you feel weak, you have no appetite, or you have too much appetite, you compensate on so many levels, and it can happen, you know, to the happiest people, you know. What does being happy mean? You know, does it mean being balanced? Does it mean being content to just what you have? You know, is it for some people it's, you know, being ambitious and fulfilling those ambitions. You know, what happy is so different to so many people.
Yeah.
And for me it was very much, you know, I just want to love my child, you know, and be the best mother I can be, the best loving mother I can be, and love my family, you know, feel a connection to my husband that I lost for a year and a half, you know, and because it's not.
But you come from two different sides of the world.
Yeah.
Do you think that on the other side, which is about the Asian side, is it more
like taboo
or more acceptable or more talked about?
Very. I think this is such an interesting question, because it's I think in Europe, I mean, I'm half French, and you know, my French side is quite conservative, very Catholic family, big family, you know. My dad alone has six brothers, you know, and you can imagine the amount of cousins that makes, and all have three kids and all that. And it's just, you kind of, I think in Europe, don't talk about it too much, you know, in these types of families. It's a little bit taboo because it's sort of seen as a weakness. And I think also you can have sometimes that Catholic guilt, which is very much like, it's not polite to talk about your problems, you know. It's sort of, you kind of keep that kind of nice surface, you know. You don't want to disturb people. It's impolite, you know. There was also very much, I think, that a little bit in my family, you know. But I had, you know, I had cousins who were clinically very depressed, you know, who then became psychologists and studied the issue because they went through it themselves. So I think still a bit taboo in Europe. It depends, probably, I don't know, Latin countries, Nordic countries, maybe in Scandinavia or whatever, they might be a bit more open, liberal to it, maybe in Germany, you know, where they talk a lot about health, mental health, you know, natural health, natural well-being, all that, might be a bit different. And then my Asian side, for sure, you just don't talk about it, you just don't mention it, it's just kind of, you know,
get over it,
it was like upwards and onwards, you know, like, I mean, my grandmother had nine kids, you know, and my mom is one of nine children, and they were all born in Laos, you know, so you can imagine it wasn't like fancy hospitals like in Singapore, whatever, back in the day.
Right.
And, you know, even my mom, who I love dearly, would say things to me when I was going through my issues, like, oh, come on, you know, your grandmother had nine kids, what's this? This one, you know? And I'm just like, yeah, but one is causing me hell, you know, it's I can't, you know? So it's not really talked about. I mean, I don't know with your...
It's the same in community, you know. My mom has nine kids, and you know, it's like, get over it. I mean, the only time I've seen her break down, crying, and I'm like, what's wrong with that woman? You know, and everything's okay, so she gets up and go, and cry, and then move on.
Yeah.
You know, so that's an expectation of moving on. I think my sisters are fine. I don't know what fine means.
Yeah.
You know? I'm the only one that's not fine because I'm so outspoken.
You're like, yeah.
They were like, oh my God, can you please shut up?
Yeah,
don't say anything.
Yeah.
Don't talk about things. But in Malay culture, I read that there's a belief in, it's called Hantu Maroyan. I read it to you. It lives in the placenta.
Yeah.
So they, to take care of this when they go through postnatal blues, right? They go to a witch doctor. Yeah. So that they will cast away the evil spirit.
Spirits.
But instead of saying that, oh my God, you know, this woman is unhappy of certain. So it's better to put it in the placenta and to get rid of it. Yeah. And then in the Chinese, so they believe that the confinement
is crucial.
So surprisingly, I went through confinement for 44 days.
And did you find that it helped?
For me, was I've always believed in self-love.
Yeah.
So for me, it's important to take care of myself.
Yes.
The connection of the child becomes later as
later.
I take care.
Yeah. Yeah.
But when I had my second child with Bianca, it was an awful period because every trimester I had high fever. And she was taller and she would kick my rib cage every night. And I was so miserable.
Yeah.
I was miserable also, I thought that she was a boy. I never wanted a boy.
Yeah.
So until a month later when the doctor said, no, it's a girl, then I was like, I was a lot happier. But there was a stage where, coping with two kids, they're 1.5 years, it's a lot, by myself.
Yeah.
Actually it's a lie, I had a helper, at that time my ex-husband was taking care of us.
Yeah.
So it's a different story, but still, coping with a new situation that you have to learn. Like you said, there's no manual.
There's no manual, there's no manual, and there's no manual for your feelings and even the logistics of handling, a small child. But going back to, like you said, Malay culture, but I think in Laos or in Thailand, where I grew up, it's very much also, they believe in evil spirits and the cleansing of the mother after, and it's still very much linked to that animist culture that we have, right? Believing in spirits, believing in that something external is affecting us, and that's why we're the way we are, But every society has their way of dealing with it.
But did you think, on the other hand, to say that it's something external also gives you a feel like it's not us. There's nothing, like it's
beyond you.
Yeah, it's beyond you. It's the guilt, because the guilt is bigger than anything else.
Yeah, yeah.
To say that it's something external, at least you're like, oh my God,
Yeah, you almost want it to be, It's like when I first talked to Michael, my husband, about how I was feeling, that I was feeling so down. And I'm like, do you think it's almost like an illness I have? I'm like, do you think they're going to diagnose me and I'll have some sort of obscure illness? And you almost want it to be. That's the scariest thing. You're like, please don't make it some sort of mental thing that they can't diagnose, or psychological, which is what I was actually going through. But it's like, you're like, please make it some sort of real illness that they can treat with antibiotics or medicine. And it's, make me just feel better. I mean, I just wanted to feel better. You can take, pop a pill and the next day you feel better. That was what I thought it was. And I think it's just not that easy, actually. Postpartum or anxiety and all that, it's just not that easy. Yeah, it's a much longer and slower process, but in the long term, you will feel much more settled than just sometimes popping.
But that's a great insight, because we never think of things like that. When we see somebody depressed a little bit, we don't understand that.
Yeah.
But nobody has voiced out like the way we voiced out. From what I know.
Yeah, I think especially since we're in Singapore, definitely people are quite quiet about it. I take every opportunity to try to mention it, because you never know when there'll be someone who is either going through postpartum or just suffering some form of depression or anxiety or panic attack disorder or whatever. So it's like, I just want to put the seed out there, put the word out there, so that it's people know about it, and I know that in Singapore there is a lot of people who probably go through it behind closed doors, and that they just don't say it. Whether it's expat women, local women, like I said, it doesn't discriminate. It can hit anytime, anyone, So I think just the more you talk about it, the better.
But it's true. I mean, on a personal note, my ex-husband went through a major depression.
Yes,
So, I mean, I didn't understand it. I had two kids, and he went through major, and I think he decided not to be on medication anymore. So he finds another journey of spirituality or religion, whatever. As long as it works for him, and he's alive, and he's that's the most important thing.
Whatever works for you at the end of the day. For me, I was lucky to go holistic, more natural, but on a longer time frame. And some it's medication, like you said, some it's religious or spiritual awakening, some it's just doing intense physical activity, whatever works for you, if it makes you feel just even 10% better, keep at it, don't give up. And I think there's always hope, you know. I think the message is also very much don't get up, give up, there'll be light at the end of the tunnel, you know. It's just that darkness will go and you will get better. Even though there will be days you feel like you will never get better and you're completely alone, you will get better, you know, very much. And I'm proof it does, because now I feel like 98.8% my old self again, you know. So I know that you can make it out of it, you know. And it just takes time. It really takes time, and you have to be patient and kind to yourself. Yeah.
So before we finish off, is there anything that people don't know about you? Now we know everything about you.
I know everything. Yeah.
Almost. Everything.
Yeah. Sorry. So that people don't know about me.
Yeah.
I think
this
tricky.
Is something that I don't know this about you.
Yeah, I think it's just that, you know, it's you know, kind of, it's a bit that don't judge a book by its cover, you know. Like, I think I've always, you know, I've been in Singapore reasonably long time now. I have a very big, you know, group of friends and people, you know, like a social group and all that. I think people just assume, you know, that you're constantly happy and this person that is, you know, maybe who hosts well and entertains well and enjoys cooking and this and that. But I think, you know, if maybe what people don't know is that I'm vulnerable, like most people, you know. I'm vulnerable. I have days where it's not so good, and I have days where I'm thriving, you know. And there are days where I still feel a little bit down in the dumps, and I don't know why. And it's I try not to overthink it, and I just day by day. I think if anything, I don't know if it's really linked to me or whatever, it's just that live in the moment, live in the present. And something that I never really paid attention to before, when people said that, I would be like, well, whatever, you know. But yeah, we have so many things to think about. I'm going here, I need to travel there. But live in the present and just enjoy every single little moment, whether it's just hugging your child, you know, having a laugh with your spouse or your friends, or, you know, seeing a wonderful movie, or, you know, going to the beach and feeling the sand in your toes. Just enjoy that very moment, because that's kind of what life is made of. And, you know, everything else is just, you know, extra.
Yeah,
you know,
true,
right? I mean, it's, I don't know how you feel about that, but yeah,
no, but it's,
I believe
so,
it's
true.
Very true.
But as you get older, I believe it more and more.
Yeah,
you know. And when you're young, of course, you
yeah.
want to go. But I think whatever you have taught, the tools that you've given, is really, really amazing and wonderful. And I really appreciate it.
Thank
because
you.
You're beautiful, you articulate, you're such a bubbly person.
Thank
and to
you.
Come out like this,
yeah.
it's incredible.
Thank you. And thank you for having me and giving me the opportunity to share this. I've been wanting to do it for a long time. It's just you don't always have the platforms,
yeah.
you know? And it's and I really, really want women out there to know that, you know, you are really not alone. It's okay, and you will be okay, you know. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Melissa. I am
thank
so
you
happy
so much.
To have you.
Thank you.
On that note, thank you very much.
Thank
we'll
you.
See you
thanks
next
for
week
watching.